useful and funny approach to it all, teaching humor skills as self-powering skills. From experience, I know she'll leave us laughing and smiling and having a good time. So you're on, Rosemarie.
Is this it?
You're on.
I'm on? Oh, cool. Okay. This is so much fun to be here, and it's always neat to be
I didn't realize
how long it had been since I was here before, but then, you know, time does indeed fly. And just let me turn my phone on vibrate. Not that anyone's going to call me, but at my age, if you put your phone on vibrate and you put it in your pocket, it's the best thing that happens to you. Yeah, well, actually, I wrote a letter to Apple, and I said, I have an app for you. And they've never answered. And I guess they're, you know, Bill Gates is, I think, a little uptight, so that's okay. We'll forgive him for that. You know, some of you know I'm a clinical social worker, and I've worked with people now for over 40 years in all sorts of situations, mostly in a private practice. And I've been doing this kind of speaking for almost that entire time. It started out sort of as an accident, and it probably is still an accident. So if it gets real bad, you can call 911 and have me removed from the room. However, I came here today to kind of share some thoughts with you, and I'm always, because I'm a very literate person, extremely well-read, very well-educated, and so I'm going to quote from one of my favorite authors, congratulations, today is your day. You're off to great places. You're off and away. You have brains in your head, feet in your shoes, and you can steer yourself any direction you choose. And so in the words of Dr. Seuss, which is about where I am, what I wanted to talk to you about is something that I think you all know. And that makes it easy for me because you already know it. And so I don't really have to tell you, but what I do want to do is reinforce it in your mind. And I do want you to feel as though what you're thinking and how you cope is the way you're supposed to be thinking and coping. Because there are those negative people around who tell you, oh, you should be thinking this way or that way. Now, I will say right off the bat that I'm going to say, I do not believe laughter is the best medicine. I tell you, if I've got an infection, all right, I want the doctor to give me an antibiotic. I don't want him to say, let's see how loudly you can laugh. Okay, that is not what we're talking about. But given that, and I do have a real issue, you know, I'm a member of several professional groups that have to do with humor and wellness. I do have an issue with the kind of lay interpretation that, oh, if you're in a good mood, everything's going to be great. Well, that's BS, because you could be in the best mood in the world, and you could get hit by a semi, all right, and your good mood didn't do a thing for you. Okay. However, given that, let me explain what happened to me. Some of you may recall that I didn't always have a cane, and I do now. Although, today's a good day. So, but a couple of years ago, you know, I'm an Italian, and on Christmas Eve, you have to practice the rite of food. And so I was in the middle of practicing the rite of food, getting it all ready for the 14 people that were coming to dinner. And my Jewish husband is very good because after all these years, he knows how to do all this stuff. I usually give him the worst jobs. And he does them nicely because he likes to eat. So I got everything kind of almost on the table, and I said to him, I said, everything's almost ready. We've just got to do blah, blah, blah when they walk in the door. I said, so I am going to take a shower, and then I'm going to come out and have a nice double martini, okay, and because that way I can just blitz through dinner, okay? I can just say, here it is, eat. I don't have to worry about who's talking to whom and who isn't talking to whom, you know, because you know the definition of a holiday in America, don't you? That's when people who are related by blood get together and pretend to have fun. But nonetheless, so I do that. I go, I take my shower. Now, I want you all to get this straight. I took the shower. I came out of the shower. Because there's a lot of misconception about what happened to me, okay? I did not fall in the shower. I'm out of the shower in a very large bathroom. And of course, I'm in a hurry. And I'm running around fat, naked, and wet. Get that picture? And I've had two mastectomies, so this is not a pretty sight. Okay? And running around, I tripped over a footstool. And I flew across, I was airborne. I hit the footstool, I went across the bathroom, literally airborne, and landed, of course, saving myself with my arm, broke my wrist, and had some kind of a fracture of my femur. Where do I end up? Against the bathroom door. So now I'm screaming for help. I've got a son asleep upstairs and a husband 2,000 square feet away from me in the TV room, but they did hear me because I am an Italian. I grew up in Newark and I can yell. Now the first aid squad comes and the biggest problem is getting the door open. So I actually had to take the door off in order to get me out of the bathroom, okay? Now why do I tell you this? Because my poor daughter goes to the hospital with me on Christmas Eve. And she's always has been anxious in the presence of physicians. Even though her grandfather was a physician, that didn't seem to help any. Whenever we were in a doctor's waiting room, Gail began to talk like a typewriter. Mommy, do you think that da-da-da-da-da? So now we're in the emergency room, and she's going, Mommy, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? You don't even know anybody here. What are you going to do? How are we going to... I said, Gail. See, this is Dr. Seuss. You thought I wasn't getting back to him. I am. Okay. I said, Gail. Look at it this way. Of course, I've got a little morphine in me, whatever. I was feeling pretty good. I never did get the martinis, but whatever they gave me was pretty nice. And I learned that in the hospital and rehab. How do you feel? Where's your pain on a scale of 1 to 10? About a 9. I'll take whatever you give me. I grew up in the 60s. What are you kidding me? And I did inhale. So, anyway... I said, Gail, look at it this way. We are going to do just fine. It's Christmas Eve. She says, everybody's off on Christmas Eve. I said, no. We're going to get a good Jewish doctor. And we did. We got a great guy who said to me when he saw me, he says, well, you're lucky you got me. He says, I don't celebrate Christmas. I said, great. I was counting on that. But why did I tell you that story? Because... you know this, when crisis hits, not that you can always prevent it, not that you welcome it, you still have choices. You still have choices. Even if somebody says you're going to be dead in 6 months, you still have a choice, hopefully, of what you're going to do with that 6 months. And so what I want to talk about today is the power, as Sue says, brains in your head, feet in your shoes, steer yourself any direction you choose. And mood is a choice. Mood is a choice. I mean, you can wake up in the morning and be cranky and have had a bad night and maybe life around you isn't exactly what you wish it to be. Some of us have adult children. How many of you have adult children? You understand what I'm talking about, right? Okay. So it may not always be the way you thought it was going to be. You know, you got to erase all those pictures of the Hallmark cards with the family around the table and everybody smiling. Anyway, so... But you have a choice of how you're going to manage it. You can talk to yourself in a negative way. You can list. I know people that are great archivists. They're historians. I do counseling. They come in my office. And I have a little clock I hide in my bookshelf. So where I'm sitting, I can see the little clock. The big clock is behind me so that my client can see it, so they can judge how much time they've got left with me. But I don't want to be looking at my wristwatch. So I see the little clock, and I'm watching the little clock go around. And I know people 45 minutes, they don't stop talking. Even if I try to intervene, they go, forget it. Okay. And they're archiving every negative thing that has ever happened in their entire life. And then they say, I think I'm depressed. And, you know, I want to say, no, poop, I'm depressed listening to you. You accomplished that in 44 minutes. And we can accomplish that with ourselves because we actually do program our moods. Our mood is indeed programmed by primarily what we tell ourselves. Okay? So, you know, little brain chemistry things, and doctors here, I'm not going to get real technical. Afterwards, ask him. But seriously, could we all smile at this moment? Go ahead, smile. There's always one or two that sit there, I'm not smiling. She says, oh, I'm not smiling. I don't care. Nobody can tell me what to do. Okay, don't smile. Everybody else who thinks they'd like to smile, I'm not asking you to get up and take your clothes off. That comes later. Okay, where's your smile? Yeah? Now, you know what we're doing while we're smiling? You know we have nothing to smile about? We're changing our brain chemistry, and nobody knows why the hell that happens. His daughter is working on it. She's going to find out, okay? It does. It changes your brain chemistry. Produces more endorphins. Those are kind of our happy hormones. Those are the hormones that make us feel better, feel more relaxed, so forth. Some people have nicknamed them the body's natural morphine. Okay. Whenever we get a lot of anxiety, a lot of adrenaline, norepinephrine, cortisol racing through our system because we've gotten frightened or scared about something, or because we've told ourselves something frightening. I mean, you can do that just by telling yourself something frightening. You know, you walk down a dark street in a not so wonderful neighborhood, and if you tell yourself, oh my God, this is going to be awful, somebody's going to pop right out of that doorway, I know it, you know. Pretty soon your heart's going to start to beat fast and so forth. Of course, you know, it depends. It's sort of like, was it the Seven Dwarfs, you know, whistle while you work, kind of. You can. But I always think of that little story we read as kids, the little train that could. You know, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can. Okay, that's really programming the brain. It is one of the things that fascinates me. I love to watch field events in track and field, probably because all my kids were involved in those kinds of things, because nobody in the Poverman family can run. Okay? They just can't. No matter how hard you try, they're slow. Okay? However, they could sure put a shot and throw a discus and do that kind of stuff. But they never were high jumpers either, but I always had to sit through those events because that's the same kind of part of the event. And I love to watch those high jumpers, those pole vaulters. Okay? Because they would stand at the end of the runway, right? And they would just, you know, stand there and with the pole, and to the point where you're almost going, go already. You know, I'm like, I can't hold my breath anymore. And then pretty soon they burst forward and they go and do their thing. Now, what do you think they're saying to themselves? Trust me, they're not saying, oh my God, that is really high. I have no idea how I'm going to get over that. No, they're saying, I can do this, I'm going to do it just like I practiced it. The act that we create around us is a climate really of choice. It's a climate of choice. You know, I said to you I had two mastectomies. Well, you know, I'm not wearing them. I'm not wearing that as a badge of courage. I mean, it happened. I kind of, when I went for the second one, which was a preventative one, the doctor said to me, are you want to do this? I said, look. I said, I'm a lot of things, but I hate being lopsided. And I can tell you this. I just want to do this because I wasn't using them for anything. The day had passed. It was over. She said, well, that's not the way to look at it. I said, but it's the way I choose to look at it. I choose to see that if this gives me a better chance. I mean, I had like a lot of female relatives die of breast cancer. I'm thinking this is a good choice to make. Now, of course, this is fancy. Everybody's doing it. I like to be first. Very competitive. You have to after I did that, I went to see the doctor one day, and she said, it's funny, sometimes people, friends, relatives, doctors even, and my surgeon was a lovely gal, I really appreciated her, respected her, but you know, she said to me, how are you doing with this? I said, fine. And then you know when you say you're fine, how people say, are you sure? You know, I mean, you guys must get that a lot. Don't you get that? Are you sure? You know, and you want to say, yeah, why do you want to fight with me about it? Yeah, no, I'm fine, okay? Accept it. And so she said, how are you making out? I thought you should have had reconstruction. See, I thought I shouldn't because I don't need that. I'll just go buy them. I didn't know how expensive they were. Very costly. So one night I'm on the computer and I'm thinking there's got to be a cheaper way. Close to $300 a boob is more than I'm willing to pay. And I found fabulous boobs for about $29.90 each. Any color you wanted, any size, any shape, with decor and without decor. On a transvestite website. So I got them. I got a bunch. I got a drawer at home with a bunch. Depends on what I'm wearing. I'll have these, I'll have those. Depends on these. Look pretty good, don't they? There's a warning, though. If you pass this along to any friends, get a separate email address and a post office box. And don't apply for any government job that requires high clearance, because you're going to get really weird emails, and some weird people are going to start getting in touch with you, but they were fine. And I only bring that to you because it's choice. It's what I do with it. And so when I said that to the surgeon, she looked at me and she said, well, I never quite looked at it that way. I said, it may not be someone else's choice, and it certainly doesn't have to be, but let it be put out there as one of the choices. Because the mood you create by the choice of what you say to yourself, of how you create options, that mood is contagious. It bounces off of the people around you. Now, you can't fix other people. Raise your right hand. Come on, everybody has one. Okay, raise your right hand and promise me I will not try to fix other people. Good, okay? Can't fix other people. You know, you can take care of young children and teach them, but you can't fix other adults. They have to want to fix themselves. And so if you create a climate in which other people are breathing that attitude, not Pollyanna, but breathing the attitude of flexibility, okay, breathing the attitude of choice, you know, it is contagious, and then it helps you. Okay, it really does help you. Now, I kind of want to just say, you know, for example, if you look at it this way, I'm told all of this is going to work, and it worked before. If you look at it this way, I don't want to hear you guys doing this. When something goes wrong. Thank you. rescue yourself, and I'm asking you today to think about the power of positive humor as a way to rescue yourself. Humor is an attitude, it's a mindset, it's a way of thinking of things. Yes, there are two handouts. The one is really kind of a little summary of what we're doing here today about remembering to laugh. Okay? But the really important one, the one I want to bring to your attention, is the one that says we have a power of choice. Humor gives us choice. Humor makes the mind's view, the perspective of things, flexible. You know, as we age, we tend to get less flexible. It isn't just a physical less flexible. We tend to get less flexible, at least the anthropologists tell us, because we look to be secure. We look to be safe. So we want things to be the way they were because that's what's familiar and it feels good. I can count on it. Problem with that is it cuts off the avenue of options. So for example, if I use my humor mindset, I'm trying to deliver an important thing here. If I use my humor mindset, okay, then I could go into a public restroom and find one of these. You know, you could even go into grungy Exxon stations and find these now. Because in the 1980s, when everybody was newly afraid of AIDS, some clown got the idea that they could make money by selling these to every restroom in the country. Because they were going to prevent you from getting a deadly sexually transmitted disease off a toilet seat. Although, honestly, I don't think that's where you'd get them. Although when I was in high school, we were all told that the captain of our cheerleading squad got pregnant off the toilet seat, but it's funny that the baby looked just like the captain of the basketball team. That's a true story. Anyway, everybody pretty much finds these things. If they're available, we tend to use them. Men not so much, women more. You know, they always remind me of my mom. Remember when your mom used to take you to the restroom when you were a little kid and you had to go so bad you'd be jumping around going, I have to go. And your mom would be peeling little pieces of paper out of the little black box on the side of the stall to cover the toilet seat before she let you sit down. And then finally she said, okay. And you had to go so badly you sat down with such gusto, little pieces of paper went everywhere. So these kind of remind me of her, because I remember all that papering she did. Now all a mother has to do is, you know, flip one of these out of a dispenser, although you still have to wait, because you have to determine whether you should take out the middle before you sit down, or you should let nature take it out. Now I gotta tell you, I don't care who takes it out. Just remember, these things are thin and they'll stick to your bottom instantly. So, when you go to get up, remember to peel. Because if you don't, this piece has been where you went. And it'll come right along with you where you're going. Just a matter of just saying, okay? I think they're kind of fun anyway because I always like to exercise options. So, like, what else could you do with this? Okay? Well, for one thing, if they're short of toilet paper, you can use this. For another thing, if you've got a bunch of kids in the van and you want to entertain them, you could grab a bunch of these and a few crayons from the McDonald's place and run out and tell them to color things on here. Make a Christmas wreath or something like that. Okay? Or you could make a picture frame for somebody you don't like real well. My favorite, though, is to make a commuter bib. a commuter bib. I like these because if you're kind of hustling along when the traffic is kind of fast and you forget and you get kind of whipped up in the commuter traffic and now they're all doing 70 and so are you, and the next thing you know, they pick on you. Well, I got to tell you, any self-respecting cop who comes over to your car and sees you wearing this will go, just take it easy. And he'll run for the hills. He's not stupid. The other thing, of course, is, you know, everybody says you cannot text while you're driving a car. You shouldn't be on your phone. I agree with all of that. What they don't warn you about is they don't warn you about drinking coffee while you're driving your car. Because I got to tell you, I don't care where you buy your coffee. You could go to Wawa, 7-Eleven, Starbucks, Dunkin' Donuts, McDonald's. They all have their own little top that's supposed to be a drip-proof top. Well, even if you bring your coffee from home in the great big travel across America, L.L. Bean stainless steel coffee mug, you take a swig, you hit a bump, and blah, 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 down your front, your coffee goes. Well, you're wearing this. The dribbles will go right here, and then when you get where you're going, you can clean up real nice, okay? And then when you take it off, you can be a good part of humanity today and save this. Because everybody wants to be green today. So you can repurpose this. And you might say, well, what will I do with it? Well, first of all, it's easy to carry with you. You could stick it in your handbag. A guy can put it in his back pocket. They fold up to nothing. When you come to a big meeting like this, and you want to sit with your friends from Raritan Valley, and you're outside, and somebody says, hurry up, go in and get us a table so we can all sit together. We've got to register. You're done. You go in. I hate when I get that job. You know, you got to put up some chairs. You got to find something to put on the table because now you're in here, but you want to go out and go to the bathroom. Not if you have this. See, if you saved one of these, all you have to do is choose the table for Southwest Jersey and throw it on the middle of the table. And this will have the little brown spots on it from your coffee. And nobody will sit at that table. And so I call this my Yahoo toilet seat cover. Yahoo. Y-A-H-O-O. You always have other options. If you've got your humor mindset plugged in, humor mindset is a mindset that allows you to laugh at absurdity. The humor mindset is a mindset that allows you to laugh when there's the opportunity to smile or laugh. And you know, kind of like the song says, I sort of like the little plant or the little dandelion that grows up between the crack and the macadam in a parking lot. Humor doesn't have to be guffaw, big, knee-slapping humor. Sometimes it's just quiet humor. It's just something close to your heart that puts a smile in your heart. But it flexes the perception. So that instead of seeing this or anything as only one conceivable thing, it gives you a sense of power to make choices. And that's really how we stay healthy of body and mind, to be able, number one, to engage our brains, to make choices in our behalf, and to feel a sense of power that that's what I'm doing and that I'm communicating that somehow. And the other thing is that humor lets you laugh whenever you can laugh and laugh at absurdity and look around to see the joy that there is. Many years ago, I was at Newark Airport, and I realized something very quickly. We were all sitting, waiting for our plane to board. A bunch of strangers just sitting around close to each other because we're all going to get on this one plane. Fortunately, it wasn't a Malaysian plane. And we're all chit-chatting with one another. But the main thing that happened was a little 4 or 5 year old little girl did something, and I can't even recall what it was now, that most of us just enjoyed laughing with her parents about. Shortly thereafter, I went to a kiosk to get a cup of coffee, and a couple of people that had been sitting in the area obviously did the same. The next thing I noticed, we were smiling at each other and talking to each other, almost as though we knew one another, because we had mutually experienced the climate of that very social, relaxed moment. In other words, we had bothered to say hello, to smile. That's so important. That's what people do to stay with their climate that they want to create. And it is a climate that we want to create. You know, we have a choice in life. We can either be a thermostat or a thermometer. A thermometer just reads the temperature of a situation, a room, a person, whatever. A thermostat sets it. So I would like you to be able to set the temperature in your life, because everybody knows what you do with a thermometer. And so now, when you leave here today, you can only take with you the thought that every time you go in a public restroom, you're going to think of this moment that we shared together. It's not like the old drinking song, "I See Your Face on a Barroom Floor." It's about remembering you spent time with Rosemarie, and we talked about this Yahoo toilet seat cover, and that I have choices. And we do have choices. I said of mood. You know, years back, I used to commute when I was living in Boston to graduate school, from my house to the graduate school. And the gal I commuted with, she came from a big Greek family, I have to say, before the movie. And she was always talking about her grandma and all the wonderful things her grandma taught her. And my friend, who was in graduate school with me, was the conduit between grandma and the outside world, because my friend, of course, could speak English and could speak Greek. And every day, we'd go by a newsstand. She'd stop and buy a paper. She always greeted the guy really nicely. "Good morning, hello, how are you?" This guy never responded. You know, cap down, dead cigar in the mouth, rah, rah, never growled or grumbled or whatever he did. And I said to her one day, "Diane," a good name for a Greek girl, "Diane," I said, "you're never going to get him to say hello." And she said, "Well, I'm not even trying." She said, "All I'm doing is making sure that he doesn't ruin my day." She said, "My grandmother told me in Greece, they say, at the beginning of the day, if you meet a grouch, meet the grouch in your best way. Because if you don't, the grouch will own your spirit for the rest of the day." Okay? She said, "So I don't say hello to him for him. I say hello to him for me." And I've always kept that in mind, and as a result, today when you leave here, you're going to find on the table outside where you registered, you're going to find a red nose that I want you to take with you. You can only take the red nose if you make a promise. Either you raise your right hand, otherwise you don't get the nose. It's not automatic, the nose. I promise to keep this nose for me.
Keep this nose for me.
The special knows. The Moobod knows. Okay. I don't want you giving it to your grandchild. I don't want you to give it to the neighbor's kid. All right. Hang on to it for yourself. You want others, go to the party store and buy one. This is your Moobod nose. I learned a long time ago that what my friend Diane and her grandmother were talking about was attitude. And there's an Australian Aborigine word, Moomba, which means let's get together and have fun. They use it at Mardi Gras time in Melbourne. They have Moomba parties. And the acronym for Moomba, as far as the humorists are concerned, is Moomba, M-O-O-M-B-A, my only obstacle must be attitude. So you kind of carry this around. You can stick it in your pocket, in the cup holder of your car. You know, in New Jersey, people cut you off, and then if you look surprised, they give you the New Jersey State salute. And we're tempted to give it back. And when you do that, that person owns you. Think of it. How many times, not to bring up, you know, uncomfortable subjects, how many times have you gone into a physician's office and the gum-smacking receptionist who dropped out of high school is less than pleasant? And you tend to start to get less than pleasant also. She owns you. Don't give your power away. Don't give your climate away. Engage your sense of humor. Frame it with your own option. And so this, carried in your handbag or in your pocket, is just a little reminder of that. It also works really well if you have a sucky day and you come home, you take off your clothes, you play some really wonderful music in the bathroom, put it on, and do a little dance. And if you can't laugh at yourself when you do that, you're in trouble. So what I want is to give you all this, a place you can go quickly, where you can reset your thermostat, where you can frame the challenge, be it a difficult person, difficult diagnosis, a difficult lifestyle, where you can reframe it so you have maximum choice, the way Dr. Seuss says, by utilizing humor. Now, I'm going to let you share my little story, where I go. And you can borrow it. You can even use it if you want to adapt it as your own, but I prefer you make your own. A little place you go that makes you happy in your head. Could be from years ago, it could be from yesterday. A favorite spot you park to watch the water, or a favorite child you enjoy playing with. A favorite passage in a book. From raucous to quiet, it doesn't matter. For me, I'll tell you what I want to do. I personally want to get a tattoo. I don't want an ordinary little girl tattoo, one of those little butterflies or some little tiny flower. I don't want that. I want a great big rose, long stem, if you will, tattooed to the inside of my leg, with the blossom open at the crotch. I intend to go to Swing and Ink in Point Pleasant to get it, where all the men are nicely bronzed, and they have the, you know, the things in them, whatever they call those, you know. Anyway, they wear leather vests. And I imagine how humorous it'll be when I pull up in the family wagon and hobble in and pull out my decal and say, here's what I want, boys. I'll enjoy that. I enjoy thinking about that. The piercings, the whole thing. And you say, why, Rosemarie? I said, well, you know, as you get old, you start to think about what's the end going to be like. And I really kind of want to go out with a little bit of a flourish. And so I figure if I'm lucky, and like my parents, I go in my 90s somewhere, when they take my wizened old body to O'Brien's, with a couple of young Turks in the basement that clean up yourself. Yeah, they do. And they're going to clean me up, And you know, it's going to be impossible for them not to see my tattoo. And once they see my tattoo, I'm going to tell you right now that these two young men are going to slap each other on the back and start laughing and asking each other what they think this old broad used to do. And then I'll know that I will have put a smile on the face of two young men at the same time. Dead. Go forth and enjoy.
Thank you so much, Rosemarie. You gave us lots to laugh about, but more important, lots to think about. Come again soon.
Don't forget to collect your noses when you leave this room. Otherwise, my husband will scold me for bringing them all the way down here and not getting them to you.